Now, I wanted to ask you, the way the world, the way we've been running for the last 3,000 years, it's been very tribal in the sense that we're running on morality. We're running on a concept of, in this tribe, we eat this animal, and it's and in another tribe, that animal might be sacred, and then that's where the wars begin. But that was that benefited us, I guess, to a certain point when we were tribal. But now we're global, and we're becoming more and more global. So we have to start to transition away from this "my way is the only way" kind of idea. I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
Well, I mean, I think you're right. The guides say self-righteousness is always the small self, or if you need to be right at the cost of somebody else being wrong, that's still the personality self seeking to reinforce itself, or the egoic structure. So, borders, they say, are created by us. I mean, they're man-made things, and we give meaning to these things, and we create walls in the belief that we need to stay separate from those people over there. And in doing so, we've kind of forgotten who they are. And the guides have said, we've denied the divine in our the ones beside us for so long that we've also denied the divine in ourselves and in the source of all things. They've said about 1,000 times through me, at least, you can't be the light and hold another in darkness. Or who you put in darkness and what you put in darkness calls you to that darkness. That's a teaching of co-resonance. It's not a teaching of right and wrong and morality. Morality, as you said, seems to be pretty subjective from culture to culture. And I think when the guides speak about these things, they speak about truth. And they say what is true is always true. It's not about convenience. It's not about perhaps the mores of a culture at a specific time. 100 years ago, we treated each other very different. 300 years ago, we certainly treated each other very different. And these things continue to sort of play out. But when they say what is true is always true, they're going back to this idea that the divine self or the aspect of you or anybody else that is eternal is always true. And the reclamation of that is the key to sort of comprehending what expresses at a level of co-resonance with all other things. So, in other words, if you think of the idea that God sees God in all of its creations, or the divine cannot deny the divine in anything else, because all things finally are of one source, you begin to move to a higher level of recognition. So, I don't get that there's anything wrong with having your buds or having your tribe or having cultural requirements. I think all of those things are fine. I think when it becomes exclusive and denying others, it becomes more problematic. And that's always the schism of separation.
Yeah, and that's the thing that's so interesting because, I mean, a perfect example is sometimes I've noticed since I've launched the show, I read the comments of things and people coming in, and most of them, I'm going to say majority of them are very positive and very thankful. But when certain people feel threatened in regards to their beliefs, the story that they've taught themselves or have been taught by either culture, by religion, by parents, by community, by country, they feel the need to defend. They feel the need because their idea of the world is being challenged in their own mind by just merely saying something that doesn't align with them. So it is so fascinating to see why we need to do that. Like, my point of view is, like, if you believe the sky is purple, that's fine. That's up to you. If you believe the sky is purple and you want to pray to the purple sky, that's all good. But don't push your beliefs on me. Let live and let live in many ways. What are your thoughts on that?
I mean, I agree with you. I don't read the comments anymore.
Okay.
I used to. The very first time I was ever interviewed and I channeled, this would have been on some cable TV show maybe 12 years ago, and nobody knew who I was or what I did. I think the first book may have just come out, and there was no press on that at all. And I was channeling on air, and the comments were scathing. It's because I look nuts, and I know I look nuts, but I do. This is how it looks when I work. And I feel all that stuff because I'm clairsentient. So I was feeling all of this negativity. Yeah. And I went to bed and I said to my guides, if you want me to do this work, why are you letting this happen? And their response was, well, as long as you care what people think about you, this is going to be an issue. It's pretty much my responsibility to deal with this. But, you know, I'm not out there to make anybody else wrong. I was raised an atheist. You know, I was a New York City kid. We went to therapy. We didn't go to church or temple or anything like that, you know. It was beyond me. And when I started waking up at around age 25, I mean, for me, that was the equivalent of moving to another country. It's like, not, if that were true, nothing was the way I thought it was. All of my secular beliefs were suddenly up to be reexamined. What the guides are actually talking about now in their books, because they're almost two-thirds through the next one, which they started about a month ago, they talk about all of the cultural systems that we've been in accord to and how all of those systems pretty much grew out of a belief in separation. So all of our memory is sort of entrenched in this idea that we're separate from the one beside us and separate from source. So now they're really working on the reclamation of those things, because we can't keep perpetuating the old as we have, because we've, according to them, you know, we've chosen as a species to make it. We're going to move beyond this wall that we've erected, or above it, because you really can't go through it, but you can lift above it to a place where the wall does not exist. And that we're choosing this basically because we have to at this point. We can't go on as we were. We have the ability to blow ourselves to kingdom come, you know, and according to them, we probably will if we keep going the way we're going. And we've decided not to, which is good news.
That's very good news. But it seems to me that there's so much stuff going on right now in the world. And that could be said of any time in history almost. Yeah. But I think we're more aware of all of the wars and the pandemic and the economies and the tribalism going on politically and all this kind of stuff. It seems it's coming to a fever pitch. Yeah. But I've also noticed that the spiritual messengers out there like yourself and a show like mine, they're starting to pop up more and more to spread this kind of light, to spread this kind of information out in the world. There's this kind of almost counterbalancing happening. Mm-hmm. Do you see the same thing?
Yeah, I do. I think that the level of consciousness that's available now is present and is being, it's kind of in the field. Mm-hmm. So the guides I work with say that all of this stuff that they're teaching is taught through co-resonance. So you hold a level of amplitude or light, if you want to say that. And basically, by presence and being, you're reclaiming what you encounter or making that allowable elsewhere. So this is part of the way things shift. In 2009, when the guides dictated the first book through me, which was called I Am the Word, they said humanity is at a time of reckoning, and a reckoning is a facing of oneself and all of one's creations. And everything that's been created in fear is going to need to be re-seen, reclaimed in a higher way. And that the process that we're in right now is that, but we don't get to reclaim anything until we see it. So, you know, I think when they, about 5 years ago, maybe six, they dictated a book called The Book of Truth. And they said, what's about to happen is that everything that's been buried is about to be exhumed. You know,
what year was that, by the way?
The year before the two presidential elections ago, right before that.
So that's a while ago, because it's exactly what happened. I mean, all this racism and hate and tribalism started to come up.
Yeah, that's what they said. And they said, you know, it has to come up in order for it to be brought to the light to be re-seen. Mm. You know, it's really that simple. Now, what we want to do with everything is point fingers at it and punish and all of that, which they say just really exacerbates. Everything that is being brought to the light is brought to the light because it has to be re-known or re-seen in a higher way. And that's the opportunity we have now if we take it. But I kind of see, and they've said this again and again, that what's going on, and they've been pretty much on track for the last 10 years around how we're operating and kind of prescient. I think all of this stuff is potentially for the good. You know, it's not that we have to focus on all the crap all the time, but you can't deny it. This isn't spiritual bypassing. You don't get to spray some perfume on some stuff and say that it smells good, you know, if it doesn't.
Now, there's something we kind of talked about a little bit earlier about the stories that we tell ourselves, the stories that we were brought up with. You know, we're not born into this life with hate in our hearts or love in our, there's all this kind of conditioning that we have going on. What's your advice on how we can break free of these stories like you did when you started to awake with your, obviously you had an extreme example, you had guides and our channeling, but for the rest of us, how can we start to break free from these stories to reevaluate the reckoning within ourselves to awaken to a higher state of consciousness?
Oh, I'm not done, and I'm not a spiritual teacher, and I'm not a guru, and I'm not enlightened. I'm this guy that shows up with this very odd ability, but I have grown a lot as a result of this. Maybe grown is the wrong word. Maybe I've
evolved.
Evolved. That's a better word for it. The guides work with attunements, energetic attunements. They say we're all radios and we're always in broadcast, and our broadcast is our consciousness. And our consciousness is what claims our reality individually and collectively. So the attunements are really simple, and they're claimed at the level of the divine self or the monad, because they say what is true is always true. So at that level, these things are always true. And a simple claim that they work with is, I know who I am in truth. I know what I am in truth. I know how I serve in truth. I am free. I am free. I am free. Now, the invocation of this is not happening at the level of personality. It's not saying, hi, I'm Paul, and I know who I am, and I know where I live. It's not all that stuff. It's the eternal self that claims that. The guides say this is the aspect of self that is innocent, free of fear, free of our idea of sin, even if you want to go there, you know, that knows who it is in spite of all evidence to the contrary. So when you claim the attunements, you're actually shifting the radio station of your field to align to the higher field that they say is always present but has been denied. So imagine there's a radio station that's always been there that you didn't know that you could play. So that's what they're supporting us in doing. The experience of it is often fairly tangible. I do, you know, workshops online and live and all that stuff. But when the guides come through with the attunements and people invoke them, you can feel the shift in the body and in the field, and your experience of things begins to be altered. This isn't like abracadabra stuff. It's not like a magic wand. But what it does do, I believe, is put in motion a shift in consciousness that you can align to. All of the books that they're delivering through me are really about this. You know, these aren't self-help books. It's not about how to manifest a better condo. It's not that stuff.
Right.
You know, other people can do that. That's not what they teach. They're really teaching a kind of mysticism, but I think in a way that's really applicable, you know, that something comes with it. It's not theory, it's practice, it's experiential, which is what I like about the work. When I began channeling, or hearing, because it took years before they began lecturing through me, I was hearing information, but I wasn't interested in the information. I was interested in the energy that would accompany the information, because you couldn't fake it. So I was, for 18 years, I sat in a room in my living room in New York City in those days with people, and we sat in the energy and took the instructions that came. And they were palpable and physically, you know, physically real and kind of life-changing. And that's what I hung on to. And it's the reason I still have to just trust this experience that they're delivering, because it's palpable. It's not just a bunch of pretty words. You can invoke it, you can feel it, you can see it in action in your own life.
I've been able to partner with Mind Valley to present you guys free master classes between 60 and 90 minutes, covering mind, body, soul, relationships, and conscious entrepreneurship. Taught by spiritual masters, yogis, spiritual thought leaders, and best-selling authors. just head over to nextlevelsoul.com/free. To watch the full video, click on the link below. And don't forget to subscribe.